Probability is the branch of mathematics that deals with uncertainty. We face uncertainty every day of our life. We get up in the morning, we don't know what the weather will be, we don't know what kind of traffic conditions we might face on the way to work, we don't know what the news might be that we hear that day. To start out with, we're going to consider very simple experiments where it's easy to know what all the possible outcomes might be. For example, if we're tossing a coin, the only things that can happen are that the coin will come up heads or it will come up tails. To mathematically model probability, we start by listing the set of all possible outcomes, which we call the sample space. Here the sample space is named S, and the set of all possible outcomes, if we're tossing a coin, would be represented by the letters H and T to correspond to the coin coming up heads or the coin coming up tails. Suppose you're going to deal a single card from a standard 52-card deck of cards. How would you describe the sample space for that experiment? Well, you would need some kind of bookkeeping scheme to represent the 52 cards. You might just number them from 1 to 52, but a perhaps better method, given what the cards consist of, would be simply to use a notation something like I'm showing here. 2 of clubs, 3 of clubs, up to the ace of clubs, 2 of diamonds, up to the ace of diamonds, and so forth. If you're familiar with a deck of cards, then it will be clear to you how each of these 52 symbols is representing a card in the standard 52-card deck. The word event is used in a special way mathematically when we're talking about probability. An event simply refers to a subset of the sample space, that is, some set of outcomes corresponding to the set of all possible outcomes, which is the sample space. Lots of games involve rolling dice. A die has 6 different numbers on it, doesn't it? It's a cube with 6 different numbers, one number on each of the faces. So if you're going to roll a die, then the 6 possible outcomes are you'll get one of the numbers from 1 to 6 on the face that's facing up when you roll the die. Here the event E is a particular subset of that set of all possible outcomes consisting of the numbers 1, 2, and 3, which is some of the outcomes. And when we talk about an event occurring, it simply means that the observed result is one of the elements of that set. So in this example, where the sample space is the set of all things that can occur when I roll the die, and E is the subset consisting of the numbers 1, 2, and 3, we would say that the event E occurs if, when we roll the die, the observed outcome that we get is one of the 3 numbers 1, 2, or 3. Now let's think about rolling a pair of dice, where one of them is red and one of them is green. And we want to keep track of the results as an ordered pair of numbers so that, for example, the pair of numbers 5, 3 means that 5, the first number in the pair, is the number that appeared on the red die, and 3, the second number in the pair, is the number on the green die. Think about this set of outcomes represented by the set E. 6 on red, 2 on green, 5 on red, 3 on green, 4 on red, 4 on green, 3 on red, 5 on green, or 2 on red and 6 on green. These outcomes are pictured in the picture shown here. And if you think about it, you'll see that the set of outcomes we're talking about is the set of outcomes described by saying that the sum of the two numbers is 8. You roll the pair of dice. If the sum of the two numbers that appear on the dice is 8, then the outcome you're observing is one of the outcomes in the event E. If we're talking about a tennis match between two players named Kim and Susan, then the set of all possible outcomes, that is the sample space, is represented by the 6 blue circles in the tree here. The 6 blue circles represent all the things that can happen when Kim and Susan play the tennis match. the winner has to win two sets. And the blue circle that I'm now pointing at would be the case where Kim wins the first set and then Susan the next two. An alternate way of representing the sample space for this tennis match would be simply to list sequentially the winners of each set. So in the notation that's being used at the bottom here, one of the possible outcomes would be for Kim to win the match in two sets. That's this outcome in the tree. Or Kim might win the first set, Susan the second set, and Kim the third, which would be this outcome in the tree, and so forth. Skipping over to SKS, representing the outcome where Susan wins the first set, Kim the second, and Susan the third, which is the outcome represented by this blue circle. What's the sample space if you're going to roll a pair of dice, a red die and a green one? It's the set of all possible outcomes shown here. One on red, one on green, one on red, two on green, three on red, four on green, five on red, five on green, six on red, four on green. We have six outcomes showing in the far left column where there's one on red, six more outcomes where there's a two on red, and so forth. And in fact, we have in our total table here 36 possible outcomes because the red die can come up six different ways, and the green die can come up six different ways. And the multiplication principle says 6 times 6 is 36, and that gives us the number of ways that the two dice can come up when we roll the pair. Here's an alternate way that you could represent that sample space, 36 pairs of numbers. Using this kind of notation, the outcome 5-3 would be the outcome where the red die has a 5 on it and the green die has a 3 on it. Now, depending on what it is you're doing, there might be some situations when it would be sufficient to use this as the sample space, the numbers from 2 to 12, if you're only interested in the sum of the numbers on the dice. And that's certainly the case in some games, such as the old game of Monopoly, where you roll a pair of dice and then you advance your piece on the playing board, the number of spaces corresponding to the sum of the numbers on the dice. If all you were interested in was the sum of the two numbers, the sum of the numbers when you roll the pair of dice has to be some number from 2 to 12. So if all you're interested in is the sum, it might be adequate simply to record the sum in some situations. But of course, if this is all that you're recording, then you can't go back and talk about what number appears on the two dice individually because you're not recording that information. So the sample space shown above is better in some sense in that it simply records more information and would therefore enable you to answer more different types of questions. Let's think about a game show where the contestant who loses gets a consolation prize in which they're allowed to choose two of five things to take home with them. The things they're choosing from are a microwave oven, a blender, a food processor, an iPod, and a camera. So the choice that's facing the contestant is to decide which two of the five prizes they're going to take home. How many different possibilities are there for what the contestant decides? Well, we're picturing them right here. The contestant might choose the microwave and the food processor, the microwave and the blender, the microwave and the camera, microwave and iPod, and so forth. There are 10 possibilities for which pair of objects the contestant chooses. The reason there are 10 possibilities is because we're simply choosing from a set of five elements, we're choosing two, and the combinations formula that we studied back in part four of the course told us how to count that number of choices. Combinations of five things choosing two will give you 10 possibilities. Now let's talk about some special events in the context of that sample space. What about the event that says the contestant chooses the camera? If the contestant chooses the camera, what does that tell us? What does that information tell us about the choice that the contestant made? It has to be one of these four choices, doesn't it? It has to be either the microwave in the camera, or the food processor in the camera, or the iPod in the camera, or the blender in the camera. If we know that the contestant chooses the camera, then that cuts the total number of cases down to these four. There are four choices, four elements out of the original sample space of 10 elements that would meet this criteria. What about the event described by saying the contestant chooses the camera but not the blender? Those outcomes would be the cases where the contestant chooses the microwave in the camera and the food processor and the camera, or the iPod and the camera. We've eliminated the case where the contestant chooses the blender and the camera. That leaves us with just these three choices from the original sample space of 10 outcomes. And what about the case where the contestant chooses either the food processor or the iPod? And this doesn't rule out the possibility of choosing both of them. We want to lump together all the cases where the contestant chooses either the food processor or the iPod. That would give us the cases shown here. Microwave and food processor, microwave and iPod, food processor and iPod. So this is the case where both of those two are selected, and then the remaining four shown here as well. So there are seven choices that the contestant can make where either the food processor or the iPod is included as one of the choices. Let's shift our attention now to Andy, who is a kid who's been trick-or-treating. He comes home with a bag containing two bananas, an apple, and an orange. And he starts pulling out fruit one piece at a time, not putting any of them back, until he gets to the apple. We want to draw a tree diagram that represents the situation, figure out some way to represent what the sample space for this experiment would be. And then we want to focus our attention on the set of outcomes in which no more than one banana gets removed from his bag in the process. Our first task is to draw the tree. So let's think about how we do that. We need to represent his pulling fruit one piece at a time out of the bag, but we're going to stop our tree whenever he gets to the apple, because that's what he's looking for. The tree might look something like the one shown here. At the first level of the tree, we represent what happens when he pulls out the first piece of fruit. He might get the apple, he might get a banana, or he might get the orange. If he gets the apple, he stops. That's what he's looking for. If he gets the banana, he pulls out another piece of fruit, which might be the other banana, or it might be the apple or orange. If his first and second pieces are the banana, then the third piece has to be either the apple or orange, because there aren't any more bananas left in the bag. He may get the apple on that third piece. If not, if he gets the orange, then he goes ahead and pulls out the final piece of fruit, which is the apple. So study this tree carefully and see if you can convince yourself that this is indeed correct for all the possible things that can happen. For example, the outcome I'm pointing at now would be the case where his first piece of fruit is the orange, and then he gets one of the bananas, which leaves in the bag one banana, the other banana, and the apple, so he might get either one of those as his next choice. So altogether, we have how many possible results, that is, how many possible outcomes for this entire process. It's just a question of counting the loose ends on the tree. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 9 possible ways this process can go. So we can think of our tree diagram as representing the sample space in the sense that the 9 outcomes shown in the tree diagram represent the 9 possible elements of the sample space. Now, if you want to make up some sample space that you can write down in some fashion without a tree, you might choose a scheme something like the one that's shown here. Simply list sequentially what he pulls out of the bag. He might get the apple as his first piece of fruit. That's represented by the outcome A. Or he might have to draw a banana, orange, and then an apple. B, B, O, A. Banana, orange, apple. Banana, A would be represented by B, B, A. Banana, orange, apple, this outcome. Banana, orange, apple, apple. Orange, banana, apple. And so forth. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 outcomes shown in the sample space, no matter whether we think of the sample space as being the tree or some other way of representing it. There are 9 different things that can happen. Now let's focus on the event, no more than one banana is selected. So we want to think about all the cases where Andy gets to the apple before pulling out more than one banana. That would eliminate some of the cases, wouldn't it? We would not look at any of the cases where he gets a banana on his first draw and on his second draw. So that would wipe out those 2 cases. It would wipe out this case. It would wipe out this case. And in fact, what it would leave us with are the 5 outcomes which have the little red boxes around them here. These are the cases where he gets to the apple without drawing more than one banana. For example, this outcome is one where he does pull one banana out of the bag before getting the orange and then the apple. 5 outcomes in the event that we're talking about here. No more than one banana selected.